Good afternoon. This is the video log of Sergeant Charles Dyer. It is April 20th, 2011. I am a resident at 5819 Hope Road, Marlow, Oklahoma 73055. I'm making this video log to document everything that's happened to me since September 26, 2008. Obviously, I can't discuss certain evidence, everything that's happened, since my current case actually involves a minor. However, in the case of my conviction or death, all transcripts, all sensitive information will be sent out to different contacts across the United States and then released via the internet. I want everybody to see everything that's against me as well as for me, and make your choice on your own whether you think I've done what the state and the federal government has tried to convict me of. Alright, I'm also going to show the corruption of the Stevens County Sheriff's Department, the FBI, the Oklahoma State Troopers, Department of Human Services, as well as the Stevens County judicial system here. Specifically, some of the things that I'm going to show are the unethical conduct of FBI agent Gene Poole. I'm going to show where he actually got caught lying on the stand in federal court and where he has physically threatened my family. I'm going to show the unprofessionalism, the corruption, and the misconduct of Judge Brent Russell right here at Stevens County in the courthouse. I'm going to show the corruption of the former district attorney, Brett Burns. I'm going to show the unethical conduct of the current district attorney, Jason Hicks. I'm going to show the unethical and unlawful conduct of social worker, Abigail Wilson. Unlawful conduct of Duncan Police Department officer, Rusty Smith. The unethical conduct of Sheriff Wayne McKinney. Now, I'm going to show this, but I still support Wayne McKinney as my sheriff just because he's the best one we've had in a long time. Least corrupt by far. And I want to think that he's a good man, but I'm still going to show what he has done to my family. I'm going to show the unethical conduct of, let me see what her name was, Vicki Lynch of the Department of Human Services here at Duncan. I think she's the one that actually heads the DHS, which we call DHS, Department of Human Services, basically their Child Protective Services here in Duncan, Oklahoma, for Stevens County area. I will present all evidence, both for me in my defense and against me, that the state and federal government have brought forward for all of my cases, any case that I've had against me, including the 203 case where I got found not guilty in front of a jury of my peers. I'm going to disclose my entire case file, everything that I have for the sexual abuse case. I will take the preliminary transcript and I'll break down some of it. And it'll be fun showing where my wife likes to lie a lot and get caught. Right here, this is going to be fun for the DA, Mr. Jason Hicks. Whenever I present this in court, he knows what this is. It's going to be a Pandora's box. And once I actually get to use this in court, I'll come back and release that stuff also. But I don't want it out there. It's kind of a pretty good weapon that I have to show that I did not commit the sexual abuse offense. I'll go into detail about the arrest that happened to me while I was in the Marine Corps and show why that happened, why they ended up releasing me and dropping everything. Oh, and I'm gonna love this, but I'm gonna go into every little juicy detail about my soon-to-be ex-wife's little life that she's leading now. I'll read some chat logs off of her computer that got extracted. Nice little sex chats while we were still married and together with other guys. I'm going to show, I think it's 16, I don't know, somewhere around 15 separate porn sites that she's gone to. also dates and times that she visited these since January 2009. I'll show every little lie that she's got caught telling during both preliminary hearing or on the stand at this last hearing that we had. What was that? Motion hearing that we had. She's been caught a lot, and we haven't called her punk card on it now. We're waiting until trial. It's going to be funny. I will release an audio that I took of my wife while we were going through our divorce proceedings. She didn't know that I was audio taping her, which it's a one-party state here, where she's admitting to doing drugs, admitting to cheating, admitting that she would commit perjury on the stand if it meant keeping her daughter from me, because she was scared to death that she was going to lose her daughter because of her drugs and stuff. She actually signed a paper for court saying that she committed adultery. Now she's trying to go back and say that she didn't commit adultery, and that she only signed that because she didn't have proper counsel. Although I have her on audio tape admitting to it, so it really doesn't matter. I'm not sure how long this is going to run. Most likely, maybe even up to 6 hours, because I've got a lot of stuff to get into. And it's very important that this stuff gets released. If somehow they do convict me, the state troopers and the deputies have already said they're going to be trying to tell the inmates wherever I am about the intricate details of my case, and they said they'd like to see how long I'll last. So in other words, if I do get convicted, they're going to try to see if they can get me killed. So I'd like this information to get out there. Anyway, so this is part one. This will end the part one of my video log, and I will continue with the rest of them at my earliest convenience. Thank you. Good afternoon. This is video log two of Charles Allen Dyer. Today I'm going to be going over the illegal kidnapping of my girlfriend's daughter and the blatant comments by CPS against the Constitution. The purpose of this video is to basically have a documentation of the events that transpired between July 2009 and December 2010 in the case of my conviction or death. At that time I would not be able to tell my story, so I'm doing it now. Alright, the time on deck right now is 1428. It is April 22nd, 2011. Alright, let me give a little backstory of what happened here. Obviously everybody knows that I got arrested for rape allegations after I got out of jail for the grenade launcher. Also, I got found not guilty with that. I moved back in with my girlfriend, then CPS gave us trouble, so I never stayed the night with my girlfriend's daughter. However, because I refused to admit to being a child molester about 6 months later, they decided that it was time to take her, and they removed her, kidnapped her. I'll get into all the details about that. I've got court records here, taped interviews with DHS. I'll get all that out here. This may take well over an hour. I'm not sure how long it's going to be. So if I have to stop it, start a new section, I will. Alright. First thing I'm going to start with is the relationship between my girlfriend, her name is Amanda, I won't give a last name, and her daughter. I'll call her I. They've been family friends since 2005. Amanda was actually my wife, Valerie Dyer's best friend in California from 2005 until around 2009. Sometime around April of 2009, my wife contacted Amanda and told her she was doing drugs and all kinds of other stuff. Anyway, Amanda thought that it was detrimental to my biological daughter's safety that she was doing all this stuff, and she contacted me. I called Valerie out on it, ended up filing for divorce in July of 2009. In August, Amanda and I decided to start a relationship, and you know, we talked on email and stuff for a long time. We'd been friends for years. We used to work out together whenever she and my wife were best friends. So I moved back in with her, or I moved in with her in August of 2009 in California. We moved back to Oklahoma in December. Now, in between August and December, I was the primary caregiver for her daughter, because she worked and I didn't at the time. I was on terminal leave from the Marine Corps. And so I woke up in the morning, took I to school, bathed her, you know, brought her home, cooked the dinners, meals for the family. I was the primary caregiver. I was the housewife, so to speak. In December, we decided that we were going to move back to Oklahoma. So December 4th, we got back to Oklahoma. Picked up my biological daughter during that month, had her around Christmas and stuff, and got into a few disputes with my wife because she found out that I was with her best friend, and that caused a lot of problems. Well, January, well, there was a lot of stuff that led up to this. January 12th, my wife had been acting real funny the last couple weeks before that, and she sent some emails that were not good, such as, you know, good luck, you're going to need it after this weekend, ha ha, ha ha, I got my daughter, you're never going to get her now, you know, you shouldn't have messed with me, that kind of stuff. Freaked me out because she did the same kind of stuff when she got me in trouble in the Marine Corps. And that stuff was dropped because she admitted that it was all a lie. So I went down to the sheriff's department. I asked them, you know, hey, something's going on. I'm not allowed to see my daughter. How do I find out if there's any charges on me? Because she did this crap a long time ago, you know, about 8 months ago. And I'm afraid that she's doing this again. And they sat me down. They talked to me for a minute. And then they told me to place my hand behind my back. Asked me if I had my weapon on me. You know, of course not. And I'm talking to Officer Seeley, Deputy Seeley. You know, we used to work together on the sheriff's department. He tells me that I'm being placed under arrest for incest. I thought he was joking at first, but he wasn't. He handcuffs me, and I get arrested at that point. Now, on this day, they detained Amanda and her daughter. They detained Amanda for 8 hours that day and didn't ask her a single question, not one question, about the dates in question of when I raped my daughter or when I did anything. Just they kept her so that they could do a video interview of her daughter, and I have that here. Let's see what we're looking at with time. Okay, I have time to read that off. I'll read off not the video transcript, but a report that was done of I that day, and I'll skim through here. Okay, they did, this is done by Abigail Wilson on January 12th, 9 p.m. at night, 2010. That was the night that I got arrested. All right, worker did an interview on this day. Worker explained the rules of the interview with I and established that she knew the difference between a truth and a lie. I agreed to tell worker the truth. She appeared truthful and honest with her answers during the interview. She spoke about school and her friends to build rapport with I. Worker asked I if she could tell the worker where she lived. She stated where she lived and stuff. Asked who lived with her. She said that it was just me and her mom. She said she told the worker that she had a couple puppies. Asked what she does for fun. She said she didn't do anything fun and that her mommy wasn't silly. But Charles was silly. And then I lifted her up into the air and played with her and stuff like that. I asked about the sleeping arrangements. Stated that she and my biological daughter shared a room in the house. And that she sleeps on the bottom bunk because she falls off the top bunk. Then they started getting into asking if teachers ever discussed with them good touch, bad touch with other students. Asked her what she names her private area. A worker asked her if anyone had touched her where her teacher was talking about. She stated no. Asked if any kids had ever touched her on her bobo, as her vagina, and she stated no. Asked if any grown-ups have ever touched her. She stated no. asked if my biological daughter had ever told her about anyone touching her. She stated no. Asked if she felt safe in her home, and she said yes, because Charles is brave and will protect her and her mommy. The worker asked, what makes Charles brave? I stated that her mother told her this because he was a Marine. The worker asked I if she ever sees her real dad. She stated, not very much, because he lives in California. She informed the worker that her grandparents loved her, talking about my mom and dad. She calls them Grandma and Grandpa. She refers to me as Dad. Asked if anyone had ever touched her in her private parts, if she would tell someone. She said yes, she would tell her mother. The worker asked I if there was anything that she wanted to tell the worker. And I stated sometimes she gets scared of Charles because he pretends to stab her with a butter knife in the stomach. And that is a fake plastic... what am I trying to say? It's one of those little rubber knives that you do practicing with. I joke around with her. Worker asked if there were any games... Excuse me. Worker asked if there's any games that Charles played with her that hurt her, and asked her if that game hurt her, and she said no. They asked if there were any games that I played with my biological daughter that might hurt her, and she stated no. Worker asked if I babysit her sometimes, and she said that I did when her mom went to school. It was actually work. She didn't know any different. Worker asked what they did when he would babysit, and she stated that I played games on the computer all the time. Asked again if she felt safe in her own home and liked living there. She stated that she has three people that keep her safe: her mommy, Charles, and her daddy. So that was the interview that was done on January 12th, 2010. And that's wrapping me up about 10 minutes. So I'll come back with the next part of it. Alright, this is part 2 of video log 2, illegal kidnapping of my girlfriend's daughter, and the blatant comments by CPS against the Constitution. The time on deck now is 14:38. What I previously went over in the last video was the initial arrest and the interview that they did with my girlfriend's daughter to see if there was any kind of sexual misconduct or abuse that had happened to her. And this was videotaped. And this is pretty much the not necessarily a transcription, but this is the report that DHS put out about that. DHS, I'm talking about CPS, the Child Protective Custody, Child Protective Services. And that's what I went over in the last video. Now I'm going to go over the next things that happened. I was arrested, obviously, that night, and the next day they found a grenade launcher, or that night they found a grenade launcher in my home whenever they executed a warrant into my home looking for DNA evidence. Now, the child in question, my biological daughter, made statements against me that I did certain sexual acts to her on specific dates, and one of those specific dates was January 2nd, which I was not alone with her during that time at all that day. That's the testimony of my girlfriend, myself, anybody else that knew where we were during that time. Now, the clothes that she wore that day were actually given over on January 2nd. These clothes that she wore on that day were given over to the officials. They took bed sheets, they took pillows, they took couch cushions, my clothes, her clothes, like all kinds of stuff. And I have the DNA report here. I will get into that whenever I get into the other case. I'll read each one specifically. They did not find my biological daughter's DNA on anything, anywhere, not even on her own clothing. There was food and things like that, and I was not on anything of hers. All they found my DNA on was the bedspread, and they found my girlfriend's DNA there. Imagine that. Wow, I was pretty appalled, you know. But anyway, moving on. So I was arrested. I went on trial for having an M203 grenade launcher in my home. I was kept in custody from January 12th, interrogated heavily during those days. Over just a grenade launcher. They never asked me one question about the sexual abuse. But they moved me to a federal detention facility and I stayed there until my trial, April, I want to say 11th. I was found not guilty, I believe April 12th, and released as far as the federal custody and returned to county custody where I came back to Stevens County, Oklahoma. At that time, I went on bail. They gave me bail for $150,000. The DA asked for $1 million because of my ties to the militia and because I was a flight risk and a threat to the community. Once again, wow. So they released me April 12th. It was the morning of the 13th, I believe, when Abigail Wilson and two armed deputies came out to the house. And she informed me that because I had a history, I was not allowed to be around children anymore. Well, I, of course, protested that. And she stated that as long as I was not alone with I, that everything was fine. I wasn't staying in the house with her at night. Everything was fine. They wouldn't come take her, and that would be all right. And they came periodically to do checks. Sometime in the April, beginning of May, end of April, beginning of May, they came over, and it was two armed deputies. Deputy Lawson was one of them. I don't remember the other deputy. And Abigail Wilson. They came to make entry into my home. I denied. I said, "No. Do you have a warrant? Do you have any kind of paperwork? Do you have anything that says that you're allowed to come into my home right now?" They said, "No." I said, "You're not coming into my home." They said, "You don't have a choice." Deputy Lawson forced the door open and allowed Abigail Wilson to come in. Now, in the deputy's defense, the deputies did not enter my home. However, Abigail Wilson did enter my home, and I was unable to get her to leave my house. But I sat down, and I had a conversation with her. During this conversation, I tried to tell her that this is a divorce custody dispute, that this was false allegations, this happened in the past. She did not care about any of that. She said, "As far as we are concerned, Mr. Dyer, you did this. You did this. And it doesn't matter if you get found not guilty in court. It doesn't matter anything else that happens. You did this, and you're always going to have a history with DHS, and there's no way to get rid of it." Wow. Okay, and I think that was, yeah, I don't remember the exact date of that, but they did violate, of course, the Fourth Amendment, I believe, by entering my home without any kind of warrant or cause and forcing their way into my house. All right, so we go along April, May, everything's fine. June, everything's fine. We get a call sometime around June 5th, June 7th, something like that, and DHS wants to talk to us. My attorney says, "Don't talk to him." I say, "I'm going to talk to him anyway," and I go down and I take a tape recorder with me. During this conversation, let me get my transcript here because I can transcribe the conversation that we had. During this conversation, DHS, Abigail Wilson, the worker, she informed me that I needed to take classes because of my propensity to sexually abuse children, and that if I refused to take these classes and admit to being a child molester, that they would possibly take I from her mother and our household. So here's some excerpts of what our conversation consisted of. Now, whenever we went in there, we were, asking, "Well, what's going on? Why are we having to do this? Why are you saying that we're not being protective parents?" And her mother was asking this. And Abigail Wilson said, "Well, we're kind of in a tough spot right now because, well, it's not that you're not a protecting parent, it's just that you're a non-believing parent." And she had made these statements in the past that she was irritated at Amanda because she didn't believe the allegations against me. Not that she wasn't protecting her daughter, but they were irritated that she did not believe, because she saw both sides of the evidence, and she knew that she was there on January 2nd, and it was impossible for anything to have happened. Okay, and then she goes on to say, "I've explained to you kind of how we don't consider the criminal case as much as what you guys are giving credit for. In other words, it doesn't even matter if you get found not guilty. You're going to have to deal with this forever." She goes on here to say that she's going to file a petition with the DA, and depending on what we do, is kind of going to decide whether or not she's going to petition to have her child taken from the home. She says, "There's no or excuse me, there's not imminent risk to I at this time. There's not like an emergency immediate custody like a lot of people kind of associate child welfare with. So she's saying right here, there is no imminent risk to the child. And you need to remember this because of what will come up later. No imminent risk to the child. There's a possibility we'll ask for a petition, ask for custody of her, just due to the fact that you two are in the same relationship, in the same home. And they informed me again that I have confirmed history and that I'm refusing to complete services. Now, these services that she asked me to complete is a two-year service plan where I have to go to a doctor and admit to being, because if you don't admit to it, you fail out to start with. So I have to admit to being a child rapist, I have to admit to raping my daughter, and then I go through a two-year program that I pay for, and the state or this company, whoever, private organization, gets the money, and I have to be subjected to all kinds of mental testing and have my penis hooked up to probes and see what I like as far as my sexual preferences. It's very invasive, very, very ridiculous. And since I'm a free American and I'm not going to pay my money to an organization like that and give up my Fifth Amendment rights and be forced to do this, I said no, of course. So they informed me at that time that if I'm saying no, that there's a possibility that they're going to take her daughter. And they tell me again, the supervisor tells me, it's not the same as a criminal trial. We just have to have enough evidence to say that the child is at risk. They could be, they are, there is a future potential that the child needing protection. So they probably could say that about anybody's child. If your child's ever at risk of maybe, I don't know, falling off the front porch or getting into a fight at school, anything where they need protection, they can take your child. I'll continue this on the next section. I'll go through this transcript some more. All right, this is video log 2. Illegal kidnapping of my girlfriend's daughter, blatant comments by CPS against the Constitution. I believe this is part 3. We're just going over some of the transcript here that I had, the conversation with DHS. I'm going to go over some more here and finish this up. So basically they're telling me that I am confirmed as a perpetrator and that I have a propensity to sexually molest children. Now at this time, the evidence they have against me is the allegations by my daughter. My daughter saying that I raped her on a specific date. That's all they have. No DNA evidence or any other proof. But I am guilty of this according to them. Alright, so here she tells me what my options are. There's a couple of options. I can turn it over to a family center service case, which means no court involvement. Work the voluntary service plan. So what she's telling me is, if I go to these courses that over 2 years will maybe treat me for my propensity to sexually molest children, that my girlfriend's daughter's not in danger. But if I don't do these classes, she's in danger. So basically she's saying, do these classes or we're going to take your kid. You're saying you're not going to work it, so at that time what I do is I would have to submit a report to the district attorney's office. She goes on to say, and I say, well, you know, what you're asking me to do is violate my Fifth Amendment rights and admit to a crime that I didn't admit commit in the first place. And, you know, that's going to destroy my case to start with, and I didn't do it. And she says, I understand that, and I'm sorry that I don't put your criminal case above my child welfare case. It's just that that's not how child welfare works. So they don't work with the law or under the law. I honestly don't care that much about your criminal case when it comes to I in the home. So I'm sorry. In other words, they don't care about the law. They don't care about what a jury says. They're just going to do what they want to do, violate the Constitution and our rights. Then I get mad at her and I tell her, you know, one thing that irritates me is whenever you come into my home and you tell my girlfriend that he is a confirmed child molester, it's confirmed that he's done this. You know what I mean? That kind of stuff, you know, it makes me mad. And she says, I understand that. And then I tell her, you know, that's kind of creeping into the area of slander. And then she looks at my girlfriend and says, he does have confirmed child welfare history. And I've made you aware of it every time that I've gone out there and you've chose to stay in the home with him. Then she says, and I'm sorry if you feel that that is slanderous, but it's just not, because it's honest and it's the truth. And then I say, it's not the truth. You come forward, you say he did this. He says, according to my case, it is the truth. And then I call her out because she tried to get my girlfriend to leave me long before this conversation. I call her out on it, saying that it's slanderous, attempting to get her to leave me and to not be with me, and try to take her away so she can't testify for me for my case, because she was there with me on the date that these supposedly happened, these allegations. And she says, no, it's to make her obvious to the facts, Mr. Dyer. And obviously we're not going to see eye to eye on this. I say obviously we're not. And then Amanda's asking if she does the course, will it keep them from taking her daughter? They're saying, no, he has to do it. It has to be both of you doing these courses. Here again, they tell me that they need to come up with a treatment plan so that they can get out of my life. That's all that it's about, is to correct the condition. So the only reason I'm there is because they want to correct my condition to rape children. Amanda asks again, you know, if I did that program just for I's sake, or if Charles just does it for I's sake, are you going to go to court and try to take my children? And she says, you know what, honestly, I'm not going to answer that because I don't know, and I have no idea because of the criminal case. That's something you definitely want to speak with about your attorney. Amanda specifically asks, so if he did that, a program just for I's sake, can you go to court and say something like what his attorney's talking about? And what they're saying is, if I go to this, you know, they can go to court and say, well, he's taking these courses and it's voluntary and he admitted to being a child molester, and that's what they wanted to do. Okay, so that was pretty much the transcript of what they said. Once again, I want to point out that they said there's no imminent risk to the child at all. No imminent risk. Alright, next thing we'll get into, alright, is the court hearing. So, I refused to sign these papers, and like they said, I refused to do these 2-year course, and like they said, if I refuse to cooperate, if I refuse to admit to this crime, that they're going to take her child. So, it was a couple weeks, I think, later, we got a paper in the mail, and I think it was last few days in September, and it said that October 13th we had to go in front of a court and show our case, or the child would be taken from the home with emergency protective custody. Okay, no problem. I hit the law books. We got a public defender. Didn't know a whole lot about what was going on, but I hit the law books, brought up everything that we needed. Thank God for the internet, right? It's a whole new ball game out there these days. You don't have to have law libraries. So, let me show you a little of what our evidence was against the state. Now, this is something that I drew up. This may take a couple minutes. It's going to be kind of dry, but this is what I drew up for the attorney. All right. The purpose of this that I drew up for them was the purpose of this report is to assist in the defense of I and Amanda against the malicious legal attacks by the district attorney, because the district attorney was the one that was wanting to take her so that her mother would be out of state and not be available to be at my trial. That helps him out, because then he gets a prosecution on me. All right, here's what I wrote up. Evidence supporting our case according to Oklahoma state law. When dealing with a child depravity parental termination case, the Oklahoma court has acknowledged the due process of the law mandates that the state must produce clear and convincing evidence that the parents have violated the code set forth in Title 10 Alpha, Article 1, Chapter 4, Part 9, Section 1, Tac 4, Tac 904. And I have that in here as Exhibit 6. The court must look at 3 distinct interests in deciding to sever the parental bond. A, parental claim to the child, B, the state's responsibility to protect underage citizens, and C, the child's rights to be free from harm, of abuse, and neglect. And this title I had in here at as Example 19, Exhibit 19 in this book. For the state to encroach into a family's life and disrupt their liberties is a serious violation of natural rights as well as Oklahoma state law. This is why clear and convincing evidence must be presented. Choices about family life is among associational rights that the Oklahoma court has ranked of basic importance in our society. Rights that are sheltered by the 14th Amendment against the state's unwarranted usurpation, disregard, or disrespect. It is fundamental in Oklahoma that the right of a parent to care, custody, companionship, and management of his or her child is a fundamental right protected by the federal and state constitutions. This is in quotations that has long been the rule of this court that parents have by nature, as well as by law, the legal right to custody of their minor children. This right will always control the judgment of the courts, unless circumstances of great weight and importance connected with the necessary welfare of the child exist to overcome the strict legal right. Unquote. This is clearly shown in 2002 Oklahoma Civil Appeals Court 58, 46 Papa 3 Delta 1289. And I had that in here as example 29. Quote, the interest of the child as well as parents' interest in preserving the preservation of the family have a constitutional dimension that must be shielded with vigor and solitude. I had that in here as example 20. I've only got about a minute. I may have to put this on another video as well. The state has completely failed to produce clear and convincing evidence that I has been deprived by the definitions set forth by the state of Oklahoma. And I put those in here as exhibit 2-5. Also, that a deprived child is a child that can be removed from the home, stated in 2000 Oklahoma Civil Appeals 6-5. I have in here as 2-8 example. And subsequently has no right to terminate parental rights due to the violations of Title 10 Alpha Article 1 Chapters 4 Part 9 Section 1 TAC 4 TAC 906 in here as Exhibit 6. Furthermore, refusal of compliance of a court mandate service plan cannot result in termination of parental rights unless the aforementioned violations can be proved. And I had those in here under examples 11 and 22. I'm going to stop there, and I'll go over the evidence that supports our case there in just a second. All right, this is video log 2, going over the illegal kidnapping of my girlfriend's daughter and the blatant comments by CPS against the Constitution. I believe this is part 3. What I was just going over is the paperwork that I drew up for the attorney for our defense. All the work that I did looking up the laws to show that the state could not take our child no matter how much they wanted. So far I went over the evidence supporting our case. So I went over the laws and I state that, you know, I have the actual, in here I have the laws and the appeal decisions and I have them numbered here. As you can see, that would be number 23. And I have them numbered in here so that, you know, as they're reading this, they can look and go, okay, you know, there's the law right there. So I have examples of everything, all my exhibits in here. Now, the next thing I was going to get into is the other evidence that's supporting our case. All right, there is, and this is talking about not my biological daughter, but my girlfriend's daughter. There is no evidence of abuse, sexual or other, in regards to I. A taped interview with I, conducted by Abigail Wilson of the DHS to determine if Mr. Dyer has ever sexually abused her, produced no evidence of abuse. On the contrary, I specifically named Mr. Dyer when asked who protect her. Mr. Dyer has been a part of day-to-day life for 4 years, and it is destructive to her well-being to remove him. There is such lack of evidence that DHS has failed in their attempt to gather enough evidence to remove I from the home and has had to make threats to I to take I on the grounds of refusing to do a voluntary service plan. That's that 2-year service plan I was talking about in the last video. Alright, so that they were using that alone, me refusing to do that 2-year course and admitting to be a child molester, to have grounds to take her from the home. Even going so far as to say that all court involvement will be dropped if Charles and Amanda would just agree to that plan. And I have that as Exhibit 14, and that's the transcript of the DHS worker that I read off in the last one. Alright, the DA claims that I is not receiving proper care and guardianship and requests that the court order her deprived and remove her from our home on 2 grounds. The first being that the mother, Amanda, is failing to protect the child from threat of harm by continuing her to allow the child to associate with Charles Dyer, even after learning Mr. Dyer's propensity to sexually abuse children. So they have already proved to Amanda, beyond a shadow of a doubt, without the legal system, that I raped my daughter on January 2nd, even though Amanda was with me all day January 2nd, and I was never alone with my daughter. But they say it's so, so it must be. The almighty government has spoken. The fact is, actually, that the state has failed to provide evidence to Mrs. Monsalve that Mr. Dyer has a propensity to sexually abuse children. They have only told her hearsay about comments that Mr. Dyer's daughter has made. She has seen DNA evidence that refutes the charges against him, as well as doctor reports that do not support that he molested his daughter. She also knows that Mrs. Dyer had her brother make false allegations on Mr. Dyer in 2009. The DHS worker has even stated that I is not in any kind of imminent threat. Once again, put as Exhibit 12, part of the transcript from DHS. And has never been abused by Mr. Dyer. The statement that Mr. Dyer has a propensity to sexually abuse children with only hearsay as evidence and no criminal conviction violates Mr. Dyer's rights to be presumed innocent until proven guilty and shows complete prejudice against Mr. Dyer by the prosecution. Allowing a child to associate with someone is not a crime without a protective order. Now, the second ground was that the mother and Charles Dyer have failed to cooperate with a voluntary plan to ensure the safety of the child. First of all, the mother did not fail to cooperate. I failed to cooperate because I will not admit to a crime that I did not commit. This ground alone is not enough to take that for the state to take a child and consider them deprived or terminate parental rights. The fact that Mr. Dyer has invoked his constitutional rights against being compelled to witness against himself by completing a service plan that requires him to admit to child molestation cannot be used against him. DHS, also known as CPS, has made it very clear that Amanda completing a service plan alone would not be satisfactory. Beyond these facts, the state has no right to force a citizen to do any type of service plan unless they can prove some reason that it is legally warranted. To do so unwarranted is against the very essence of what being a free American is about, against the Constitution, and against Cicero's natural law, which the Constitution is based on. And then I just went over with some motivations that the state would have to file false depravity reports. All right. I'll go over some of the law stuff. Once again, it's going to be dry, so if you want to fast forward past this and go to something a little more exciting that I'll get into here in a little bit, by all means, please do. Alright, this is Oklahoma State Statutes Title 10 Alpha, Children and Juvenile Codes, Article 2, Section 2TAC 1005. Now this goes into what the state can remove a child from the home for. It says, no order of the court providing for the initial or continued removal of a child, alleged or adjudicated, delinquent, or in need of supervision from the child's home shall be entered unless the court finds that one of these following things happens. They have to do a determination as to whether or not reasonable efforts have been made to prevent the need for the removal of the child. Now, what reasonable efforts did they make? They tried to get me to admit to being a child molester. That's it. And once I refused to do that, they no longer let me stay in the home with her. A determination as to whether or not the absence of effort to prevent the removal of the child of the home is reasonable upon consideration of the family circumstances. Okay, here's what they have to prove before they can take the child from the home. A court of competent jurisdiction has determined that the parent has subjected the child to one of the following aggravated circumstances: abandonment, torture, chronic abuse, sexual abuse, or chronic life-threatening neglect of the child. So they have to determine that the parent has subjected the child to sexual abuse. They already said that this didn't happen. Obviously, murder of another child, involuntary manslaughter, a bunch of other things they go through here. Now, as far as the behavioral health treatment, the class that they wanted me to go to, under Title 10 Alpha, Article 1, Chapter 3, Section 1, Tac 3, Tac 103. It says that no peace officer, employee of the court, employee of the Department of Human Services, or person consenting or not consenting to medical treatment or behavioral health evaluation or treatment in accordance with the provisions of this title shall have any liability, civil or criminal, for such actions. So they can't hold it against you for not going to these health classes for 2 years. Now, here's a termination of a parent's rights to a child. They shall not terminate, the court shall not terminate the rights of a parent unless the child has been adjudicated to be deprived either prior to or concurrently with the proceeding to terminate the parental's rights. Termination of parental rights is in the best interest of the child. The court may terminate the right of a parent to a child based on the following legal grounds. If you have written consent from the parent to do so. Talks about voluntary consent. If you have abandoned your child, the child is abandoned as an infant, voluntarily placed in physical custody of DHS, Department of Human Services, or there's a finding that the parent has failed to correct the condition which led to the deprived adjudication of the child, and the parent has been given at least 3 months to correct the condition. So this is after they have taken the child, or after they've given you your ultimatums to correct. What mine was to take a class admitting to being a child molester. Okay. Or a finding that the parent has been convicted. Here we go. This is number 8. A finding that the parent has been convicted in a court of competent jurisdiction in any state of the following acts: rape or rape by instrumentation, lewd molestation of a child under 16 years of age, or number 9 here, they have failed to protect the child from abuse or neglect that is heinous or shocking. So, I have not been convicted of rape or rape by instrumentation. I have not been convicted of lewd molestation of a child under 16 years of age. And we did not fail to protect I from abuse or neglect that is heinous or shocking. Still, the laws show that they cannot take our child. And I've got all kinds of appeal court decisions where they say that they can't take the child. So, this was what I was taking into the courtroom. And I'm going to wrap it up here and continue with the stuff that gets real good on these next videos. Alright, video log 2 for Sergeant Charles Dyer. This part is the illegal kidnapping of my girlfriend's daughter. Blatant comments by CPS against the Constitution. I believe this is part 5 of this one. The time on deck is 15:17, April 22nd. I believe I just got through going over the dry legal mumbo jumbo of what the state has to prove in order to take your child. And I've proved beyond a shadow of doubt with all of that that we haven't violated any laws and they had no right to take our child. Beyond that, I also had video or taped audio conversation with DHS, and they said that there was no danger to the child, no imminent threat to the child whatsoever, no imminent risk. And that's very important because of the paperwork that they end up filing on us. Now, they, after this conversation, go to the DA, and the DA files a paper asking the court to give us a hearing to find the child deprived and let the state take the child. Now, that was filed by Brett T. Burns, the district attorney at Stevens County. He is no longer the district attorney now. Now it is Jason Hicks, but at the time it was Brett T. Burns. He has his own law offices in Anadarko now, Anadarko, Oklahoma. Now, these are the two reasons why he wanted to take the child from the home, away from her mother, devastating the child, devastating our family. The first reason, the mother, Amanda, is failing to protect the child from the threat of harm by continuing to allow the child to associate with Charles Dyer even after learning Mr. Dyer's propensity to sexually abuse children. And I went over that propensity to sexually abuse children in one of the previous videos. Number 2, the mother and Charles Dyer have failed to cooperate with a voluntary plan to ensure the safety of the child. Now, according to Oklahoma state law, number 2 failing to cooperate with a plan cannot be used as a reason to take the child alone. You must have other surrounding circumstances. So they have to fall back on one. The mother is failing to protect the child from the threat of harm by continuing. So basically, she's allowing her daughter to associate with me. Last time I checked, there is no law against allowing somebody to associate with someone. Unless I have been convicted of child molestation, which I have not. So, they have not a leg to stand on, and I have all these laws that I went through that totally prove our side. No way they can take our child. I'm ready to hit the court. So, we hit the courtroom October 13th. Let's see, I believe that's when it was. I believe it was October 13th. And we are ready to put on our case. Now, they don't allow me to come into the courtroom. They only allow Amanda to go in there alone. Which, that's fine, because she's ready too. She goes into the courtroom, and all of the attorneys go into the back room with the judge. Her attorney comes out and says that the judge has already made his decision, and that Amanda will sign a piece of paper saying that her daughter will never see me again, ever have any contact with me again. And that if he has to see the evidence that we are going to present to the court, he will automatically find her deprived and take her. So if we put on our case, they are going to automatically take her. She doesn't know what to do. So she says, no, I'm not signing anything right now. Hold on just a minute. And she goes out into the hallway and comes over to me, distraught, saying they're saying that if I don't sign this paperwork right now, saying that you can never have contact again, that they're just going to take my daughter. They're just going to take her. The judge said if he has to see any evidence today, that he'll find her deprived. Now, this judge is Judge Brent, I believe, G. Russell? Brent Russell, out of Stevens County, Oklahoma, at the Stevens County Courthouse. If anybody wants his business phone number, it's easy to look up. Just look up Stevens County Courthouse. Please give him a call and let him know that what he did was BS. So, this was October 13th. This happened. We talked for just a minute, and then the judge comes out into the hallway. Now, nobody knows this is the judge. We hadn't seen him up to this point. So, he comes out into the hallway, and he talks to our attorney off to the side. And I don't know who this is, and I'm straining, looking at our attorney. And I hear him say, you have your client sign this right now, or we're going to go back into that courtroom, and I'm going to find her deprived, and we will take her today. And I'm just like appalled at what I'm hearing. And he turns around, he looks at me, and he says, what are you looking at? You got some kind of problem? I said, what the hell are you looking at? You got some kind of problem? I didn't say shit to you. And he goes ballistic, yelling, saying that, he's got nothing to do with this case. Get him out of here. Just going nuts. Obviously, I don't know who this guy is, but he is prejudiced against me. So, I thought it was the DA, actually, at the time. He walks away. They go back into the courtroom, and I ask the attorney, who in the hell was that? And she said, that's the judge. And I'm just like, oh, hell. So, they've got our balls now. I mean, what can we do? What can we do? Our child's going to be taken today, or the mother can agree to sign some paperwork saying that she can never see me again. So we have no choice. Our mother goes back into the courtroom and says, okay, I'll sign it. Now, she doesn't sign anything at this time. You know, I said, just go ahead, tell them you're going to sign that. We'll think of something. You know, we cannot let them take her today. We'll think of something. So she goes in, she signs that. We come back out, and I don't know how this can happen, that they did this. The attorney doesn't know how they did this. I can't figure out how they did this. They can't come to my house and take my car. They can't take my child, or excuse me, my house. They can't take any of my property without going in front of a court, having a hearing, and deciding that I'm not allowed to have that property or the state should take that property. But if it's your child, all they have to do is just say, I'm going to take her, without evidence, without proof, and tell you that if you are going to use your rights of due process. If you were going to actually try to use due process, we're just going to take that from you. It's like them coming to you and saying, I want you to sign your car over to us or we're going to take it. And if you even step in front of a court to say a reason why we shouldn't take your car, we're just going to take it. Tyranny much? Is this tyranny? Absolutely. This is tyranny. It does not get any more tyrannical than this. I guess you're on a bread and water diet in a concrete hole somewhere, which that is not far from the truth now, I'm supposing. But anyway, so this is what they did to my family. So October 13th, I come home and I'm distraught. And I write something as a blog and I post it all over the internet. And you might want to see this. It's fairly interesting, I guess. It was just basically how I felt that night. It may take a few more minutes than what I have here to read it, so I will set that on part 6 of the next video. Alright, this is video log 2 of Sergeant Charles Dyer, going over the illegal kidnapping of my girlfriend's daughter and the comments of CPS against the Constitution. Now, in the last one, I talked about our court hearing on October 13th. The evidence that we had, the evidence that the state had against us, which was nothing whatsoever. And then their attempt at, or their threatening of us to take my girlfriend's daughter from us. Now, when we walked out of the courtroom on the 13th, I was supposed to never see her daughter again. Ever. Never. Not even to say goodbye. Now, here's what I wrote on a few different websites. It was just sort of a little story over what happened. I'm just going to read it word for word as written that day. I sat for 4 hours alone tonight with tears streaming down my face. During this time, there must have been 1,000 questions that ran through my head. The main one, how can the government take our children without due process? How can they destroy a family without hearing both sides of a story? Refusing even to hear both sides of the story. Now, you may be wondering how I could have such strong feelings about the family in New Hampshire. Now, this is the time around the Jonathan Irish case in New Hampshire. But the truth is, this isn't about them. This is a story about my family. I had court today against the Child Protective Services. It was supposed to be a cut and dry case, and here's the backstory. Now, I just went in and I talked about the child molestation case against me, the evidence that was against me was the allegations itself, how I started a relationship with Amanda, and how Amanda and her daughter were my life. And now I say, those two girls are the best things that ever happened to me. She, speaking about Amanda, is a patriot and fully awake. Her daughter asks when Mommy and I are getting married so that we can be a family. I explain to her that we are a family. Not having a government document doesn't lessen our familial bond. But again, I am proven wrong by the government. I try not to cry as I'm thinking about this next sentence. Tonight, I got on my knees beside the bed with my daughter and said the last bedtime prayer that I ever will with her, and kissed her on the forehead for the last time. She has no idea that tonight was the last time that she'll see me. All I can do now is sit and cry with her mother, as a tyrannical government has now stolen my family from me because of my refusal to back down or shut up. The CPS case. Because there were allegations of child sexual abuse made against me, and because I live with a child in my home, CPS stepped in back in April and told me that I could never be alone with the child. I gladly cooperated, wanting no trouble with the agency after the horror stories that I have heard. We decided to allow my daughter to stay, and this we're talking about her child. She calls me Daddy. I refer to her as my daughter. We decided to allow my daughter to stay with my parents at night, which she adamantly refers to as her grandma and grandpa. CPS came to my home on several occasions And one time, I told them they could not enter my home without some type of paperwork. The deputy said that you don't have a choice, and they opened the door and forced their way in. And of course, I had no way to defend myself at that time. They informed me that they were going to take her daughter if she continued to allow her to associate with me. I explained to the worker that this is because of false allegations and I will be found not guilty at my trial. She sternly informed me that it didn't matter if I was found not guilty. They didn't have to uphold the same level of evidence as a criminal court. All they have to do is have belief that harm may come to the child at some time in the future. Harm may come to the child at some time in the future. Do you realize the ramifications of that? Every child may have harm come to them in the future. And if they may, they will take your child, or they have the ability to. And as far as she and CPS were concerned, I was a child molester, and even if I get found not guilty, that changes nothing, because once CPS has you down as having a history, it doesn't go away. And even if I move to another state, they will contact the CPS in that state and report that I'm a child molester. Next, they told us that in order to keep from having the court involvement, all I had to do was take a sexual predator class where I would be forced to admit that I'm a child molester, and I have to go through therapy to correct the condition. And I talk a little bit about the two reasons that they're trying to take her, and the interview with the child, how nothing showed that there was any evidence against me whatsoever. And then this brings us to court today, the court hearing, or lack thereof. After months of researching Oklahoma state laws and family court cases, case laws outlining what they can and cannot take your child for, we showed up this morning, quite positive that we would win this case. Not to mention, we showed up with a videotape of my wife admitting to drug use, adultery, and willingness to commit perjury to win our custody dispute. And an audio tape of the CPS worker saying there was no imminent threat to the child. We were ready to go to war. My girlfriend went into the courtroom with our court-appointed attorney, and the attorneys placed our case paperwork all over the table and was ready to fight. The DA called the attorney out of the courtroom. She came back and informed my girlfriend that the judge was going to rule that I have no contact with her daughter whatsoever. My girlfriend argued with the attorney and asked how they could do this without seeing our evidence, and that this wasn't right. The attorney said that she needed to sign paperwork agreeing not to allow me to see her daughter, and she would take non-offender sex abuse classes and therapy. If she refused and made the judge do a hearing at all, that he would adjudicate her child as deprived, at which time the child can be taken as a ward of the state. She argued with her attorney and the DA about the situation, that it wasn't right, it wasn't fair, that the judge would rule before ever even hearing her evidence. How could the judge not care? That isn't his job. After a lengthy argument, she requested to speak with me in the hallway. Once I found out about the situation, I was floored with the same question. While speaking to the attorney, a man motioned to our attorney to come to him. He spoke in a low tone, saying that if her client refused to sign, that the child would be adjudicated deprived. And then I just talk about how the judge and I sort of got into it. I was about 15 feet away from the guy, and we got into it there. And we were appalled and confused about what was going on. There is no longer a presumption of innocence in this country. A lot of you already know that. We knew at this point that the judge had no care about what we had to say or the people's rights that he is charged with protecting. He was bought and paid for by someone with much more power than we have. My girlfriend agreed to sign the document and went back into the courtroom. The attorney went to the back with the judge once again, and when she came back, she informed my girlfriend that now, because of the altercation that we had, the judge wants the Dyers completely out of it, and they can have no contact with her daughter. That means that my mother, a nurse of 68 years of age with a perfect record, and my father, a preacher of 73 years of age with a perfect record, minus a speeding ticket in the 80s, are no longer allowed to be around a child that they refer to as their grandchild. Now, I don't know what they did. They didn't sexually molest anyone either. I'm not sure exactly. They're not even being charged with anything, so I don't know why they couldn't see them. Anyway, they let me stay there then, so I didn't have to get kicked out of the house here and live on the streets. My afterthought, my girlfriend has cried almost constantly for the last 11 hours. She looked up at me today with watery eyes and pain in her heart as I embraced her, and she asked me, what do we do? How do we fight against this? How can we keep them from doing this to us? I pulled her close to me so she could not see the tears that were welling up in my eyes, because I knew the only answer that I could give her was one that I couldn't bear for her to see. My heart is broken. My will to continue fighting the legal process with petitions and the use of law, a flickering flame, all but extinguished by mistreatment, lies, threats, stripping of rights, multiple false statements, and continual constitutional violations. To what length is a normal American expected to continue to use the legal system? Is it after their rights have been stripped, their homes invaded, their families destroyed, their children stolen, and the legal system refuses to even make a simple attempt at defending a person's rights? Please ask yourself that after you finish reading this. At what point would you stand up and say, no more? And I will continue on the next video. Alright, this is video log 2 about the kidnapping of my girlfriend's daughter. I don't even remember what part this is. I believe it's part 7. Let's see, I just went over the court hearing and the statement that I put out on the internet. Now, that statement that I just read wasn't the original, because I remember inside, on the original, I wrote on there how I was filling my M16 magazines with tears streaming down my eyes and prepping my body armor. And if anybody can find the original of that, please, if you could send that to my YouTube account or Sergeant Dyer 80, SGTDYER80@yahoo.com. So I no longer have a copy of that. All right, so these were all actions that happened on October 13th. So we were refused the due process that we should have if they're trying to take anything that's ours, especially a child. We were told if we brought in our evidence that the child would automatically be taken. And I had written this thing up on the internet talking about basically how I was fed up that they could attack my family like this. Now, at this time, nothing had been signed. She agreed to sign paperwork saying that I would never be around the child again and they would allow her to leave the courtroom with her child that day. Now, she didn't sign anything. We got home and we decided that, you know, this isn't right. We have to fight this. We can't just let them get away with this. So, we thought, how do we fight them and alleviate the risk that they may honestly even believe that there is? And we came up with the idea, the plan, that we send her daughter to my sister's. And my sister loves her to death. She loves my sister. My sister is an amazing person. Better parent than I am, that's for sure. And so we send her to Tennessee to be with my sister while we are going to stay here and we're going to fight them, because what they're doing is wrong. And we are red-blooded Americans that believe in standing up for what we believe in and not just letting them roll over us, which is what they want you to do. Just let them roll over you and they'll leave you alone. Admit to doing things, go to prison, do what we want and we'll leave you alone. And that's not the way we roll. So, on the 18th of October, which was 5 days after this court hearing, my sister drove down from Tennessee, picked her up, and drove back with her. And actually on the 15th, let me back up a little bit. 2 days after this court hearing, I called the sheriff. And I told the sheriff, hey, Wayne McKinney's our sheriff here. Hey, Wayne, I told you I'd be open and honest with you. You know, I don't want you thinking I'm a threat or anything around here. Here's the deal. There is possibly an emergency protective order that's going to come down, and they're going to ask you to come and steal my child. When they do, I ask, all that you do is give me a call. Let me know that you're coming, and we'll work something out. But I guarantee you, you do not want to come here and take my child, because I will defend my family. He says, well, you know, there's nothing come down. We haven't heard any orders. But, you know, thank you for keeping an open line of communication. How are you doing? We talked for a while. And that was it. Now, moving forward to the 18th, my sister came down, got her daughter, and we didn't tell anybody that her daughter was going to Tennessee because we wanted them to think that she was here so that we could legally fight them and they wouldn't go behind our back and steal her and kidnap her somewhere else. So my sister got her on the 18th. Hours after my sister got her, probably 6 hours after my sister got her, the sheriff calls and he says, "Hey, listen, I just got a protective order across my desk and it's for your girlfriend's daughter. And what I'm needing you to do, I need you to bring her down here to the office and turn her over to us." I said, "Wayne, I'm sorry. You know that I can't do that." And he says, "It's really important. I need you to do that." I said, "No, it's not going to happen. I'm not doing it." He said, "All right, well, I'm going to have to grab some deputies and I'll be out there in a few hours." And I said, "If you think that you're going to come out here and get her without a fight, it's not going to happen." He said, "Well, I'm going to be out there in a few hours with a few deputies and we're going to get her." And I said, "All right, Wayne, I will meet you on the battlefield." And he says, "Whoa, whoa, what are you talking about? You're going to meet me on the battlefield?" I said, "Well, if you're going to come here armed, point weapons at my family, and think you're going to kidnap a member of my family, I'll meet you on the battlefield." He says, "Oh, easy, easy, take it easy, y'all. Listen, you just calm down a little bit, relax, and I'll call you back in a couple hours." So he calls me back, I want to say an hour or two after that, and he's on his cell phone now, not a recorded line. And he says, "You know, what's going on? You know, how's things going? How you feeling now? Do you feel any better now? Is everything all right?" I said, "No, it's not all right. You know, you're going to come out here and break up my family and assault me. And no, I'm not okay with that at all." And he says, "Okay, well, listen, there's not a protective order. There's no protective order. You know, I've just heard rumor around the office that there might be. So, you know, just relax. Nobody's coming out there. No big deal." Okay. You know, this is very suspicious to me, but okay. So I kind of stand down and relax a little bit. Now, the next day, on the 19th, I believe it was, let's see here. Yeah, oh, and that day I made the call to different groups around the United States and they were starting to move in. And after I got the call that there wasn't a protective order, we kind of stood down on that. Now the 19th, this is when things get real interesting. Let's see, okay, I think I have time to tell about a little bit of this. On the 19th, I get a call from a contact of mine that says that he overheard in the courthouse, they were talking about having a task force together and talking about how to deal with Mr. Dyer with the least amount of bloodshed possible. I kind of freak out a little bit about this and I call a contact at the sheriff's department. Now this person at the sheriff's department is a deputy down there and he tells me that, yeah, there is a task force down there and he's not a part of it and they're across the building and they're deciding how to best deal with me without bloodshed. He says he wants me to just turn myself in and that they don't want to treat, he mentioned Ruby Ridge and Waco, he don't want to turn this into another Ruby Ridge, and he's a Marine and if he comes out here we're gonna have to fight each other. He says that this is all a bunch of political bullshit, but in the end he and I are going to be the ones killing each other, and he doesn't want that, and he mentions Ruby Ridge, and so I'm like, wow. I get off the phone with him. There's no warrants for my arrest. I don't know what's going on. I skip town. I got a call shortly after that from a contact of mine in Lawton. He said the FBI just contacted him, and they were looking for me. And then I got a call from a contact of mine in Tulsa, and the state trooper Terrorist Task Force Division was looking for me and they asked him how they could deal with me best with the least amount of bloodshed possible. He told them, leave him alone. So the 19th we take off. I actually went to my contact in Lawton. I figured that the FBI was over there, they're not gonna be looking for me there. So we stayed in Lawton and that was the 19th. We stayed there the 20th. Now I can't remember if it was the 20th or the 21st. For the sake of this, I'm going to say it was the afternoon of the 20th. All 19th, I'm calling the FBI, asking what's going on. I'm calling the deputies, finding out what's going on. You know, I don't want somebody coming over, killing me and my girlfriend. So we're out. I'm not trying to be on the run. I'm on the phone with them all day these days. I will end this here and come back. Still, this gets kind of interesting. And we'll be back in the next video. All right, video log two. I don't even remember what part I'm on. I know that I was talking about being on the lam for a couple of days. That was the 19th and 20th. Yeah. Okay, so I had to Lawton and I stayed the night on the 19th with one of my contacts in Lawton. And I'm on the phone with the FBI pretty much all day on the 19th, trying to figure out what's going on. They can't figure out what's going on, but there's definitely a task force out trying to figure something out, what to do with me, because I'm such a danger and a threat. Wow. Whole task force. Apparently the FBI, state troopers, and local law enforcement all trying to sit around a room and figure out how to get poor little old me sitting in my trailer. Wow. Wow. Anyway, so 20th or 21st, can't remember what it is, I'm on the phone with the FBI. They finally call me back and they say, hey, listen, everything is diffused. You are safe to go home. Nobody's going to mess with you. The local law enforcement and state law enforcement have been told they are not allowed on your property and to leave you alone. So I start heading home. About 20 minutes after this call, Sheriff Wayne McKinney calls me and he says, hey, listen, the DHS, I don't believe with this, but the DHS went behind my back. They found out that your daughter was in Tennessee and they are picking her up right now as we speak. I pretty much was ballistic, as was her mother at this point. We come home that afternoon, and from here it was an insane fight mentally inside. It was a struggle not to want to go get her back by force, by any means necessary, because she's now in state custody and I didn't do anything wrong. Her mother didn't do anything wrong. Now, when they went and got her, remember they had two reasons why they were trying to get her in the beginning. And, you know, the law wouldn't allow them to take it, so they had to get a judge to circumvent the law, Brent Russell, to let them take her. Let me find what my paperwork here where it's talking about the reasons now. All right, so. Now, if you remember, on the 18th, the sheriff called and said that there was a protective order. Misleading me? I don't know. I like Wayne McKinney. I like our sheriff, and I support him. So it's hard for me to say this. But there's a possibility that he was trying to goad me into a fight so that they could take her. I don't know, and I hate to say that. But on the 18th, when he said that there was a protective order, there was no protective order signed. As you can see, this is on the 19th. Here, let's see if I can do this without showing any names. It says right here on the 19th that the 19th of October 2010, Abigail Wilson had this signed by a judge. Now, here's the reasons why now they're trying to take her. And this is the reasons that a judge allowed them to take her. Let's see here. It goes through, it says, number one, I'm a child welfare worker. So not all these are reasons. It just states that, you know, she's a child welfare worker, that she's recommending services. It says here that, here's one of the reasons, on April 16, 2010, the person responsible for the child's care, that was us, Amanda and I, agreed that Mr. Dyer would not stay at the residence during nighttime and would have no unsupervised interactions with the minor child. We did that. We followed that, actually. On or around 6/08/2010, worker spoke with persons responsible for child, Mr. Charles Dyer and Miss Amanda, and to recommend a voluntary service plan be completed, and the above safety plan remains intact during this time. The service plan would include sexual offender program for Mr. Dyer to address his propensity to offend, and a non-offender program for Mrs. Amanda. So, all they want me to do is complete the service plan and say that I like to rape children. Wow. Anyway, of course, Mr. Dyer has refused the voluntary service plan and stated that Miss Amanda would work the plan if she needed to. Worker requested a petition to be filed to find the child deprived due to the lack of cooperation by the PRFCs, that's us, and the foreseeable risk of an alleged sex offender living at the residence. So I'm already guilty. There is no innocence until the state proves my guilt. I am guilty until I prove my innocence. That's the way things run now. Next reason here. All right. Amanda's agreement to complete a voluntary service plan. This plan included that Mr. Charles Dyer and any person associated with him, including his family, would not have contact, supervised or unsupervised, with the child. So, now what they're using is whenever they forced her, under extreme duress, to agree to sign a service plan, which never was signed, stating that that my family, none of my family would ever have contact with her child again. They're using that against her. As of this date, service plan has not been signed. See, it says there it wasn't signed. On Friday, October 15th, 2010, Sheriff Wayne McKinney received a telephone call from Mr. Dyer. Mr. Dyer advised Sheriff McKinney that he would not be abiding by the state recommendations and that he is prepared to take up arms to protect his family. Am I not allowed to take up arms to protect my family? Isn't that something that's part of our Constitution and the groundwork for our country? Isn't that what our entire country is founded on? Taking up arms to defend our family from a tyrannical government? I guess not. I'm wrong. Mr. Dyer stated that he was aware that DHS would be filing for emergency custody and would be using the Stevens County Sheriff's Office to initiate the order. Mr. Dyer stated that he respected the sheriff and his deputies and did not want them involved. Mr. Dyer continued to tell Sheriff McKinney that they will not be signing the service plan or abiding by it. Hell no, I wasn't going to sign it or abide by it. And I'm being honest. I'm not trying to subvert the law or do anything I'm not supposed to. We're not going to sign that thing. Now, you'll love this one. Here's a reason that they took her from us. Mr. Dyer communicates with fellow militia members via the internet. In the blogs, Mr. Dyer has stated the following on October 13th, 2010 at 11:51 p.m. I sat for 4 hours alone tonight with tears streaming down my face, doing the best I could to fill M16 magazines, prep body armor, and adjust my gear, barely able to see. During this time, there must have been 1,000 questions that ran through my head. So it was the beginning of that one that I read earlier, and I don't have that. According to Lieutenant Lawson Guthrie, Mr. Dyer's statements are extremely alarming and need to be addressed immediately due to his history and his comments about bearing arms to protect his family. So I guess if anybody out there that says that they have the right to bear arms to protect their family, you could lose your child. Mr. Dyer also admits to being in the home with the child after the court hearing, where he and Miss agreed that he would have no contact with her daughter. Mr. Dyer stated in his blogs that he was continuing contact with the child. Now here's my statement. Here's how I continued to have contact with the child. Mr. Dyer stated, "Tonight I got on my knees beside the bed with my daughter and said the last bedtime prayer that I ever will with her, and kissed her on the forehead for the last time. She has no idea that tonight was the last time that she'll see me. All I can do now is sit and cry with her mother, as the tyrannical government has now stolen my family from me because of my refusal to back down or shut up." So because I prayed with my daughter and kissed her on the forehead for the last time, because I said goodbye to her, they're going to take her from me. On October 19th, 2010, Worker was informed that Amanda and Mr. Charles Dyer picked up the child from school on October 18th. Mr. Charles Dyer continues to have access to the child, and Miss Amanda is not willing or able to protect her child from the foreseeable dangers that Mr. Dyer poses. And since I wasn't ever alone with her, I guess the foreseeable dangers would be Amanda sitting there and watching me rape her daughter. Yeah, I don't think so. Now, this worker, this is Abigail Wilson, this worker believes the child has been placed in inordinate, imminent risk of health and safety. This is the exact same worker that during the taped conversation with DHS said that the child was in no imminent danger. And then they sign to take her, which they did do. They went to Tennessee and they kidnapped her. And I'll carry that on in the next segment. Hi, this is my video log 2 about them kidnapping my girlfriend's daughter. And it is now 1600, so it looks like this may be running into about 2 hours. And man, the stories I could tell if people were here. Alright, I was just going over them kidnapping her. So they went to Tennessee. And they kidnapped her from 900 miles away from where I am because I'm a danger being, or she's in danger being around me. And I guess 900 miles is far too close. So they kidnapped her and they brought her back to Oklahoma. And they held her from October 20th or 21st, not sure of which date it is, 20th or 21st. And they held her until the 16th of the following month. Now, during this time when they got her, they would not allow her mother to see her at home. She's never been away from family for this long. You know, somebody's family. People she didn't know. She was with a foster home somewhere. They wouldn't tell us where she was. We were allowed to have no contact with her. And then, after about a week of them having her, they finally allowed, not me, but her mother, to have phone contact with her only when the foster parent deemed it necessary. So if the foster parent didn't want to call, they wouldn't. If they did, they decided whether or not her daughter actually had any contact on the phone with her. Now obviously I was not allowed to have any contact at all. If I would so much as talked on the phone with her, they would take her. Right now, if I call and talk on the phone with her and DHS finds out about it, they will call DHS in that state and they will take her. So this moves us on, let's see, it was about somewhere around October 30th, I think it was, we had the next court hearing to decide whether or not the state would keep her. There was about 12 of my friends that showed up, and we hung out and protested in front of the courthouse. At the end of that day, at the court hearing, they decided that they were going to keep her. So once again, there was no contact whatsoever between Amanda and her child. And it wasn't until the 16th that they gave her back. They had a court hearing on the 17th. And they told her that if she would sign a paper saying that she would leave the state and never return with her daughter, and never allow her daughter to see me or any of my family or anybody that even thinks that I didn't commit this crime again, that they would give her back. If she refused to sign this, saying that she would leave the state forever, they wouldn't give her back. So she agreed to sign it, and the court hearing was on the 17th that she was supposed to get her back, but they did it on the 16th because they said they didn't want me bringing my group down there again and protesting. So they gave her back a whole day early because of that. I think they didn't like the thought that we were going to cause trouble if they did this again and kept her. So, in summary, I refused to admit to a crime, and the state illegally kidnapped and took her daughter, and there was nothing we could do about it. And here's the kicker. Here's the kicker. At the court hearing at the end of October, after they decided they were going to keep her, they asked me to come and have a meeting with DHS, which is CPS, Child Protective Services, in the sheriff's office. So I did, with one of my friends, Rick Light, of a well-regulated American militia website. And we went and we had a discussion with the sheriff and DHS, Department of Human Services. During this time, Abigail Wilson told me that I could never be around children for the rest of my life, and that I could never be around Amanda's daughter for the rest of my life, and it didn't matter if I got found guilty or not. I told her that she didn't have the right to circumvent the Constitution, our rule of law, and a jury verdict. And she said, "Mr. Dyer, that's your opinion." And I asked, and she's saying this in front of Sheriff Wayne McKinney, "How in the hell can you do this? You can't circumvent the Constitution, a rule of law, and a jury verdict." And she said, "Well, I'll put it to you this way, Mr. Dyer. If there's a man, and we know that he raped his daughter because there's DNA evidence, and she's pregnant with a child that meets his DNA, so we know it happened 100%, and they go to trial, and he gets found not guilty, are we supposed to just walk away and let this guy be with his child?" Well, I said, "First of all, you're dealing with what-ifs here, and that would never happen. But okay, I'll go with you. If he's found not guilty by a jury of his peers, there is a reason he is found not guilty by a jury of his peers. And by you still punishing him, you're violating the Constitution and our entire rule of law. You can't do that." And she states, "That's your opinion, Mr. Dyer." Wow. So look at what they're getting away with. Look at my story and realize that this is just one story. One story. Thousands of these happen a day. Thousands across the United States, maybe tens of thousands, I don't know. I've read statistics that say out of 17 children that get taken by protective custody, one probably needs to be taken, and the other 16 don't. They get paid for this, they get paid to take children. If they can terminate rights and adopt the child off, they get paid extra for that. This is what's happening in our country right now. And I'm just one case. One. This is happening every day. They have no right to do what they do, and they don't care. When are we going to stand up? When are we going to say no more? It concerns me. It concerns me that the American people are out there doing nothing. You want a reason to fight? How about this? Is this not a reason enough to stand up and say, "Hell no, you're not going to take our children and use our children against us simply because I say that I'm going to defend my family or because I talk with militia groups online?" Militia, is that a dirty word? And why is it a dirty word? By Oklahoma state statute, it's everyone that's a male between the age of 6 and I believe 65 that would assist the governor in a time of national distress. So, why is that a dirty word? Because I would. I'll assist my neighbors. I'll protect my neighbors. I'd give my life for almost any man. I don't think of it as a dirty word. But because of who I am, the things that I say, the speeches that I've given, this is what has happened. And I'm not alone. This isn't just happening to me. But I want you all to think about this. Think about what I've said here. And if there's any part of it that you don't believe about it, ask me. I'll send you the paperwork. It's public record right down here at Stevens County Courthouse if you want to drive down here or have them fax something to you as well. I'm not hiding anything, and you've got every bit here what I have about them taking our child. Anyway, this is Sergeant Charles Dyer signing off for Video Log 2. I'll be back with probably even more goodies later. Thank you. This is Sergeant Charles Dyer on Video Log 3, Part 1. The date is 23rd of April. Time on deck is 18:53. On this video log, I'm going to go over some of the illegal, immoral, and unprofessional acts that have been committed against my family by different government agencies. I'm going to go over the personnel and what they did. The purpose of this log is to record these acts that have been committed against my family in the case that I am incarcerated, killed, or am unable for some other reason to give my side of the story. Alright, now I've got these set up in a top 10 countdown, so I'll just start with number 10 on here. Number 10 wasn't such a huge deal. Violated one of my rights of the Constitution, my Bill of Rights. Judge Carl Lamar of the Stevens County Courthouse. He gave me, in my eyes, a excessive bail. But looking at what the DA asked for, it was not so excessive. The district attorney was asking for $1 million bail because I'm a threat to the community, a flight risk, all of these things. Now, I've never committed a crime, never been convicted of crime. I have a perfect record. I have a speeding ticket when I was 18, I think. I'm 30 now. I have dual honorable discharges from the military, not so much as a negative counseling in the military, secret security clearance, worked for the sheriff's department, I've kept my nose clean. However, they thought that necessary to give me a $150,000 bail to keep me from running. And I don't have $150,000 laying around, so I had to rely on my family, my parents. They put their property in their home, the farm, up for mortgage, and had to give $15,000 cash they won't get back no matter what to a bail bond agent. So that's number 10. Number 9, Officer Rusty Smith of the Duncan Police Department. In November, I went over to, and let me back up real quick, I don't live in the city, I live out in the country, 9 miles northeast of Duncan, about 3 miles from Duncan Lake. So, that being said, over at Duncan Lake, they have what appears to be public dumping for trash. They've got a large trash bin, and then all around the lake, they have the little white, look like burn barrels, like the 55-gallon drums, where you deposit trash. Nowhere around the lake does it say not to put trash there. On the eastern side of the lake, nothing says anything about not depositing your trash. I put 3 bags of trash in these burn barrels. Now, the city workers that were over there found my name in some of the trash, and so, I don't know, they knew who I was or whatever. They contacted Rusty Smith of the Duncan Police Department. He's the lake ranger out there. And they got all the trash that they could find around that side of the lake, 13 bags, large, hefty bags of trash. They drove 3 miles outside of lake property, backed up. I watched them with my own eyes, and then I videotaped what they put out there. They backed onto my property, and they dumped all these bags of trash, and I bagged them. This was just loose trash that they dumped all over my yard, including but not limited to broken glass, used condoms, all kinds of nastiness from over at the lake. And I bagged that up and paid a guy to haul it off. So, number 9. Number 8, Brett Williams of the ATF. Now this guy, I've sat down and I've talked to him, and he doesn't seem like a horrible human being. However, what bothered me about him here was when I had my bail hearing, my federal bail hearing, he got on the stand and told the judge that I had illegal equipment in my home. That illegal equipment was a silencer for an M4 rifle, and that I was not allowed to have that silencer. I wasn't licensed to have that silencer. Now, the facts behind the case were that that silencer was for an airsoft rifle. And it was given to me by YouTube user IllChemist07. And I actually have the receipt where that was bought off of eBay. And that receipt was given to them to prove that it was a silencer. But he got in front of a judge and told him that it was a real, or he didn't say it was a real silencer. He said he was checking, but he said it was a silencer that I had for an M4. Later, we went back and looked. He did know at that time that it wasn't a real silencer, and he had told my family he had it sent to Washington, D.C. to be checked, when in actuality, on the report, it said that he shined a flashlight into it and knew immediately that it was not a real silencer. But he didn't say that at bail, my bail hearing, and I was eventually denied bail and had to sit in jail for 3 months and wait for my trial, which I was found not guilty of anyway. All right, number 7, Jason Hicks. He's the current district attorney at the Stevens County Courthouse in this district. Don't have a lot of problem with him. I actually tried my best to get him elected here because he was the best candidate. He just got elected at the beginning of this year. My problem with him, I had a lot of respect with him till this, and I can't speak too much about this because it's involving a current case. However, he helped to suppress evidence for 4 months that a judge finally forced him to give us. And while we had it, we found evidence that pretty much shows beyond a shadow of doubt that my wife did set me up and plan on making false allegations against me. And now that we have found it, he's trying to do everything he can to suppress it and keep the court from using it so a jury can't hear it. So he's not looking for the truth, he's looking for a prosecution, which he's a prosecutor, what do you expect? Number 6, Audrey Caldwell. He was the U.S. attorney for my federal trial. During my bail hearing, he had told the judge that I was a member of the militia and that they had an underground where they could sweep people away and they would never be found again. Now, he was saying this as if he knew this as a fact. The problem is, I'm sitting here saying, wow, he knows something that I don't. Number one, I'm not a member of any militia. Just because I've trained with, you know, different groups, I'm not a member of a militia. There is no one here that would join me. So, he also told the judge that I was a threat to the community, even though I've never been arrested or convicted for a violent crime in my life. He mentioned my speeches to the judge, so I guess I don't have a First Amendment right to speak my mind and say what I want because it will be used against me judicially to keep me from getting a bail hearing or whatever they want to use it against. Yes, and while I was in federal detention, he came to me with a deal. It was about February or March of 2010, and he told me that if I would admit to the crime of failing to register an M203 grenade launcher, that I would be home by Christmas. Now, I told him to shove off a little bit stronger than that, and because of that, about 3 weeks later, my roommate was removed from my cell, my cellmate in the detention facility, and then I learned that Audrey Caldwell was now going to use him as a witness against me because he convinced this guy to roll over on me, basically, and say that I admitted all of my crimes to him. Of course, there's a little thing about they offered him a little time off to say this. So they did that, and because I found some stuff in the guy's trash that he left and made it known, they decided not to use him against me because he had no credibility whatsoever, and it was just a ploy that they were trying to use to scare me into admitting to a crime that I did not commit. Oh yes, I was just informed that to inform you that he also had the roommate say that I was going to pay him $5,000 to kill my wife. First of all, why am I going to pay someone $5,000 that's going to be in prison for a minimum of the next 8 years or so to pay my wife or to kill my wife? Second of all, I didn't have $5,000 to pay him in the first place. So, number five, Brett Burns. This is the old district attorney that got voted out this year, at the beginning of the year. All right, that evidence that the current district attorney is suppressing, the old district attorney suppressed for 11 months. We asked for it over and over and over again, and he suppressed it and suppressed it and suppressed it. Probably because he knew damn well that that would make him lose this whole thing. He also asked for $1 million bail on the grounds that I was a threat to the community, flight risk, all of the normal BS that the federal prosecution also was saying. He signed the protective order that had my girlfriend's daughter taken from her so that she would have to leave the state and not be able, he was hoping that we would get into some kind of fight or something and get split up so that she wouldn't come back down here and get on the stand for me, because she was present during the time that I allegedly raped my daughter, and she's my alibi, and they didn't want that. During my preliminary hearing, whenever we were going over the rape case, he all of a sudden tells the judge, oh yeah, and this is 7 months after I got arrested, and because I refused to admit to this, he says, oh yeah, the grenade launcher, I want to charge him for that. And the judge says, well, there are some questions of double jeopardy there. He was found not guilty. He says, yeah, that's right. I want to charge him for possession of, what was it? Possession of stolen property, that's right. And the judge says, well, okay, I'll allow it. So now I'm facing the grenade launcher charge again, even though I was found not guilty and proved that I didn't even know that it was a 40 millimeter, blah, blah, blah. Let's see. Okay, that pretty much wraps up the first five. I'll put the next five in part two. All right, this is video log three of Sergeant Charles Allen Dyer, part two. And I had said that I went over the first five. I believe I went over the first six agencies that committed acts against my family. All right, I'm on number four here. This is the Stevens County Sheriff's Office. I'm not putting blame on any one person. Definitely not Sheriff McKinney, although I could place blame on him, but I try to support him the best I can. I think it's very important for people to support their sheriff, especially if they're a constitutionalist. And mine is, although he has trouble standing up for what he should a lot. All right, and the first thing I'll go over is what happened with the sheriff. I told on one of the videos before, I think in log two, I don't remember which part, in one of the middle ones, where the sheriff had called me and lied to me saying that there was a protective order to take my girlfriend's daughter, trying to provoke me into a fight. I ended up not falling for it, and then he admitted there was no protective order. The next thing, officer or deputy Lawson Guthrie, which he's a Marine, I have respect for him as well, I don't have any hatred for him, but he did hold open a door and basically force entry to allow Abigail Wilson of the DHS to enter my home. He himself and his other deputy did not enter my home, just the DHS worker. This next one, I don't know who to place any blame on here, because I'm not sure who exactly did it other than my wife. I don't know which deputy did this, but And I don't remember the date. I can get that if anybody wants it. I went to a court hearing, and whenever I exited the courthouse, my wife and my girlfriend got into an argument about 20 meters away from me. I was at the top of the court steps. They were at the bottom. And I finally told my girlfriend, hey, don't worry about it. You know, we've got video evidence against her. She admitted to this stuff. Let's go. And my wife freaks out, you know, screaming that, I have no right. It's illegal to videotape her, which it's not. It's a one-party state here. And she comes running up the court steps, starts poking me in the face, poking me in the chest, screaming at me, F-word every 2 seconds. You know, what's it like having everybody think you fucked your daughter? Just going nuts on me, right? And I turned away from her 45 degrees, crossed my arms, told my girlfriend to go get the deputies. Deputies came out. We went inside. I went upstairs with them. She went downstairs with them. She told them that I assaulted her, even though she ran to me, ran up the stairs, started poking me in the face, that I assaulted her. I ran to her and assaulted her. Now, my mother was there and witnessed it and knew better, told them better. My girlfriend was there and witnessed it and told them what happened. But poor little Valerie, they believed her and they arrested me for a violation of protective order. About 2 hours later, after they finally did some investigation, they found out that Valerie was lying and that I did not violate my protective order, and they released me. Actually, I think it was more like maybe an hour and a half. This is after they fingerprinted me. I was in oranges again, getting ready to go back to a cell. Actually, they were going to stick me in a cell naked because I refused to answer their questions. I wasn't cooperating with them. I wonder why. The next thing is, I won't say the deputy's name. I worked with him a long time ago. I don't want to have any hard feelings against him either. However, whether he is lying or he is mistaken, I'm not sure. But he says that whenever I was arrested for the child abuse, incest, child molestation, whichever it was in the beginning, that I signed a waiver and refused to speak to them. Now, I did not refuse to speak with them. I would have answered any questions that they wanted, just like with the M203. Although that was, I guess, not really willingly talking to them. But I'll get into that here later. And if you don't believe me on that, that I didn't sign anything, which they don't have anything signed, they had my girlfriend in their custody for 8 hours. 8 hours after I got arrested. You know how many questions they asked her about the rape charge? None. Did they ask her if she was present on January 2nd when this alleged rape happened? No. Did they ask her how my daughter acts around me? No. They didn't ask her anything. My parents, who were apparently in the home and present when I allegedly raped my daughter, how many questions I asked them? None. Zero. They don't care. There was no investigation done whatsoever. They took the allegation and they went on a witch hunt. No investigation. And that moves me to number three. This is an evil, evil person. Abigail Wilson of the Duncan, or Stevens County, it's in Duncan, but Stevens County Department of Human Services. Most places it's called Child Protective Services. This woman, she has lied on an affidavit, protective order to kidnap my girlfriend's daughter. She put on there that her daughter was in imminent risk of danger, I believe it was, imminent threat. Now, we have an audio recording of her with us saying there was no imminent threat to this child. But then she turns right around and signs on an affidavit that there is imminent threat. She made a statement to me that the Department of Human Services, CPS, have the power to supersede the Constitution. They can overrule the Constitution. They can overrule a jury verdict. They can overrule our rule of law. And whenever I told him, no, you don't have the right to do that, she makes the statement, well, that's your opinion, Mr. Dyer. She also told me that if I admitted to being a child molester and took the voluntary classes, that they would not get any court involvement with me as far as my girlfriend's daughter, and she can keep her child, I can stay in the home, no problem. But if I refuse to admit to being a child molester, that they're going to take the child, which I refused to be a child. I refused to admit to it, and they ended up taking the child, which you can see in video log 2. I don't remember which part. I think that was pretty much the whole thing. Video log 2 told all about it. Also, she used the sheriff's department to enter my home. They forced entry into my home whenever I was there, telling them I didn't want her to enter without some kind of warrant or paperwork that she can be there. I didn't even know who she was. You know, I couldn't confirm that she was even DHS at that time. She came in and was telling me things like, you did this, you know, I don't care about a jury verdict or if you're found guilty or not, it doesn't matter to me, you did this. Telling my girlfriend he did this, he's a confirmed child molester, I'm showing you the evidence, he's a confirmed. Now, they didn't show her any evidence at all, you know, but once again, beside the fact she was present here in the home on the day that this supposedly happened, but you know, you are, he's a confirmed child molester, you have to leave him. If you don't and you try to have a family, we're going to follow you to every state you ever go to for the rest of your life, we're going to take your daughter from you, basically we're just going to harass you forever. Oh, that brings me to number 2, and boy, talk about an evil, evil man. This guy is a judge at the Stevens County Courthouse. His name is Brent Russell. Where to start with him? I think I'll just start with the double jeopardy, all right? He is allowing the state to charge me with having the grenade launcher that I was found not guilty of in federal court. All that they did is they changed the name of it from failing to register a destructive device is what I got found not guilty of, and now they're charging me with possession of stolen property, even though I already proved that I didn't know, first of all, that it was even a 40 millimeter. So we'll go with that, and then this, I don't understand why he did this other than the fact that he's extremely biased against me. During the DHS hearing, whenever they were trying to take Amanda's daughter from her, he comes outside and is talking to the attorney saying if she doesn't sign this, they're going to take her child, which I talked about in video log 2. And, you know, he looks at me and he says, you know, what are you looking at? You got some kind of problem with me. We get into an altercation. He yells at me to stay out of this or I'm going to take her child. So, okay, because I'm helping Amanda stand up for her rights, because he's not able to run over her like everyone else in this county, he's going to automatically take her child. And eventually, he did. He signed the order to have the child kidnapped from Tennessee, 900 miles away, because I was a danger to her. I guess I was going to rape her by mail or something. I'm not really sure. I spoke earlier about the altercation I had with my wife in front of the courthouse where she was poking me in the face and yelling at me. I tried to get a protective order on her that day. This judge denied it. I have no idea why, but he denied it. After she got me arrested, poking me in the face, that's assault, and he doesn't care because he's biased against me. Now, this is the same judge also who signed a protective order from Valerie to me. Now, obviously, she's not that afraid of me if she's running up to me, poking me in the face and stuff. But she had a protective order put on me. Now, here's the protective order. I know it's kind of grainy, so you can't see all of this, but this is the protective order here. I was with this woman for 12 years. During this time, never did she ever make any kind of report to law enforcement, or anyone else for that matter, that I ever tried to threaten her, harm her, or did anything physically violent toward her whatsoever. However, after I was arrested for child molestation, she goes down and files this protective order saying that I caused or attempted to cause serious physical harm to her, that I threatened her, that I harassed her, and that I have stalked her. I don't know how I was stalking her, because I was always around with my girlfriend, but, you know, maybe my girlfriend stalked her with me, I guess. I'm not sure. And in here it says that, please describe why you were making this charge. And she puts, charges against him concerning my daughter about rape and sodomy and about his militia he is around and in, threatening me all the time, saying it would be very easy to kill me and bury me somewhere. I am scared of him and what he might do to me and also my daughter. Interesting. But anyway, because of this, there was a protective order hearing that I was not allowed to go to and defend myself. So an emergency protective order, or a final protective order, was issued against me, stripping me of my Second Amendment rights until the year 2013. I have not been convicted of a crime. I am not violent. And because my wife, the same one who was making the allegations against me falsely for sexual abuse, made false allegations against me for this protective order, and my Second Amendment rights have been stripped away. Now, Second Amendment rights given to you by... Now, there's the question. I am one of the believers that the Founding Fathers believed that that right was given to us by our Creator to defend ourselves. So a right, not a privilege, a right cannot be stripped from you. However, mine has. Tyranny much? So, that is Brent Russell, the judge at Stevens County Courthouse. Looks like I only have about less than a minute on this one. So, the last one I'm going to save for the most evil, conniving person I have ever dealt with in my entire life. And he works for the FBI. We'll come back to that one on the next one. Alright, this is video log 3, part 3 of Sergeant Charles Dyer's video logs. And this whole section here will be for one individual. This man works for the FBI, and his name is Agent Gene Poole. Okay. Here's what I'll start off with. I'll start off with the first time I ever met this man. After I got arrested for, I think initially it was incest, I got pulled into an office with Agent Gene Poole, and he informed me that they found an M203 grenade launcher in my home. Now, I told him, obviously, no, you did not find an M203 in my home. And, of course, he said he did, whatever. He started questioning me about it. I told him, I'm not going to talk to you. You know, because he was, frankly, an asshole. But I said, I'm not going to talk to you. I think I'll speak to an attorney. And he looks at me and he says, if you ask for an attorney one more time, I'm going to stop this interview. And I'm going to arrest your girlfriend for 5 years for every weapon that's in your home, whether it's legal or not. That's like, what, 25 years, right? And we're going to take her away from her child, and her child's never going to see her again. And it'll be because you didn't cooperate with this. Okay. Well, I, of course, protested against him and said, well, guess what? I know that my fiance is not a convicted felon. I know that for a fact. And he says, no, actually she is. She was arrested for cocaine, and I don't remember what year that was, but he did mention it. And it was before I ever met her. And she told me about that. Now, the details around that was that it was her boyfriend's. She was arrested on it. And then she had to do, I believe, a probationary time, but there was nothing that ever came out of it. She left the boyfriend immediately after that, and never had anything to do with him again. He is also actually the father of her child, and he's currently in prison. So anyway, but you know, they called my punk card on it and said that she was a felon. And I got very nervous about it. I thought, I said, okay, you know what? I didn't do nothing illegal. Let's talk. What do you want to know? And so that was the beginning of our wonderful relationship, him threatening me. Now, after this, he went to my mother's house. And this was days after. This wasn't that same night. This was days after. My mother is 68 years old, I believe. He looks at her and says, if you don't cooperate with us, Mr. Dyer, we'll make enough charges to put your son away for 40 years. Now think about this statement. Make enough charges to put your son away for 40 years. Now I'm being charged with failure to register a destructive device. Maximum sentence is 10 years. So how is he going to quote unquote make enough charges to put me away for 40 years? Unless that's what he does, make stuff up. He took my mask and my speech whenever I was arrested. What either of those have to do with rape or having a grenade launcher, I'm not sure. But they did do it. They took my mask and my speech that I was working on. They made a C4 dog hit on my storage unit in town so that they could open it up and look at it without a warrant. What did they find inside? That's right, nothing at all, except for some old flight helmets of my grandfather's, his Capitol police badge, some things like that, that they ended up taking and giving back. He lied at my federal trial. Now, the whole reason that I had the federal charges come up on placed on me was because he signed the indictment saying that I admitted that I had a 40-millimeter grenade launcher. Now, when we got him on the stand, now this is what the indictment said, that I admitted to it. When we got him on the stand, he was asked three separate times in different ways, and that is a jackass. Okay, I'm back. I have to leave that in there. I'm not going to edit that out because it was so critically perfect. And you're right, Mr. Donkey. Agent Poole did make a jackass out of himself right on the stand in front of a federal jury. So he was asked three separate times by my attorney in different ways, did Mr. Dyer ever tell you that this was a 40 millimeter? And he knew that it was a 40 millimeter. No, he did not. He expressed each individual time that he thought that it was a 37 millimeter. Now, after there were no more questions, the U.S. attorney, Andre, mess his name up all the time, Caldwell, gets up there, and you can tell the frustration on his face, and he's sitting here with a piece of paper. And he says, Agent Poole, I'm going to give you a piece of paper, and it's a report that you made, and see if this maybe jogs your memory. So he goes over and he approaches Agent Poole and he gives him this piece of paper. And here is Agent Poole's exact reaction. Don't believe me. Go get the transcript. It's at the Oklahoma City 10th District Court. All right. And if you want my case number, I will give it to you and you can get the transcript yourself. Agent Poole looks at it and says, oh, that's right. He did tell me that he thought it was a 40 millimeter. Right. Nobody buys it, Poole. The jury didn't buy it. Nobody bought it. It was too late at that point. Once again, Mr. Donkey was right. What's the next thing that we're going to hear? Light at the federal trial. Oh, yes, let's go to the state preliminary. All right, at preliminary, they called him to testify about the grenade launcher again. Now, all through the federal trial, over and over, they stated these certain facts. The grenade launcher was taken in 2006 from Fort Irwin, which is an army base. The grenade launcher found it into the hands of a man in California who, through, I'm not exactly how he got it or what his affiliation with different groups were. It's possible that he was a weapons dealer or something. I don't know exactly everything. However, it was given to me by this individual. So, at the state preliminary hearing, this same FBI agent gets up there and he tells the judge that this grenade launcher came from Camp Pendleton, which is the base that I was at. This grenade launcher was never at Camp Pendleton. You can check the NCIC. I don't know if you can get a report of that or not. I'm sure I probably could if you didn't believe it. Anyway, it came from Camp Irwin, not Camp Pendleton, but he said it came from Camp Pendleton and that I had acquired it from a wall locker on Camp Pendleton. For those of you that are military out there, you know what a wall locker is. It's the personal space, basically a closet for military personnel in barracks. So there was just this grenade launcher just laying around in a wall locker that I picked up in Camp Pendleton. Wow. Not a far fetch, right? Kind of, yeah. But anyway, the judge buys it. It allows the state to try to prosecute me on this. And I think that'll pretty much cover Mr. Poole. There's other things I won't get into right now. Other people that I won't get into right now. Certain things that affect my case that's going on at the moment, which, oh, I would love to present, and I will very soon, especially after we catch some more individuals lying on the stand, which they already have repeatedly. I want so bad to read transcripts to you, but I will in the next videos. Thank you for listening.